And so if no one did that, then no change will begin. Now, it is defined as the aversion to work or exertion, evolving through time to mean laziness or indolence. That's ora, or indolence, or being idle. Yung walang ginagawa, yung nakatinga lamang buong time. No? Just moving, floating around, not doing anything. Okay, I remember before I told my aunt this, Mama, I want to have a holiday. And I'm going to name my holiday. Okay, and that holiday of mine, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to become as idle as possible. Mama Ada said, sure thing, goding, go for it. Okay? So she leaves. But you know, bless her heart, my grandma. Okay? She didn't do any of the chores. She left the stack of plates right there. She left the car dirty. She left all the laundry uncleaned and all that. So by half the day, I knew that I couldn't become idle. I needed to start cleaning up. And so, watch that, okay? Watch that, that simple thing. I didn't know about this slothfulness is a deadly sin and all that during that time. But you see, God moved right away and stated, no, my servant is not going to be slothful. He's not going to stay and become idle or indolent. Instead, he will busy his hands, okay? An empty mind is a devil's workshop. Let me repeat that again. An empty mind is a devil's workshop. And when we're not doing anything, that's when we feel that we need to sin. Amen? That's when lust, that's when anger, that's when hate, that's when all the things in the world that we so fear to fall into comes into play. When we are not doing anything. But when we are busy with something, what happens? No time to sin. No time to sin. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Alrighty, let's continue on. So the Hebrew Bible condemns sloth and speaks against it in the Old Testament. Okay? So we're going to look at Proverbs 18:9. And it says here, can anyone read this? Does anyone want to volunteer to read this for me? Just grab that mic again and have someone read it. Who wants to read it? Sandra, could you read it for me, please? Just a read. Could you do it for me? Just this short verse. Okay? Okay, do the blue one, okay? Blue one is Sandra. Okay.
Okay, online.
One who is slack in his work is brother to one who destroys.
One who is slack in his work is brother to one who destroys. Do you know why Solomon actually wrote this? I've been thinking about it. I actually did. I sat down earlier and I said, how come being slothful means that you are almost a destroyer? And you know why? Because if you don't do anything to defend something, you're as good as destroying this thing. Okay? Notice, huh? Kunwari po, no? May magandang-maganda tayong bahay. Ang trabaho natin ay linisin itong bahay na ito, di ba? Pero paano kung hindi natin ililinis na ilang araw, or ilang linggo, or ilang buwan, or isang taon? Ano nangyayari sa kanya? Siya ay unti-unting dudumi. And at the same time, magkakaroon ako ano-anong mga bagay. Amag, cobwebs, agyo, all that. And slowly but surely, magkakaroon ka na ng termite problems. To a point na, you didn't do anything, you're so lazy not to do anything, that you, in every sense, destroyed that house. Amen? The person who doesn't do anything is a destroyer already. Okay? Notice the term by Edmund Burke in World War II. He stated, the greatest evil is for good men to do nothing. I didn't know that he was pertaining to sloth right there. He was pertaining to sloth as it is. Because just notice that it's just that. Good men doing nothing is the greatest evil. It's that painful of truth. Okay, and this particular wisdom has been shared to us by Solomon. known as the wisest of kings. Okay, he was the son of King David, and though he was rich in wisdom, but very poor in lifestyle, but his writings truly manifested and won our hearts with Proverbs, Song of Songs, and Ecclesiastes. Okay, and we know and we've seen how good it is to actually follow these things. Okay, and it is imperative for us to truly understand that this man truly had wisdom. Now, the main theme of Solomon was the virtue of hard work and the evil of laziness. Hebrew culture focused on strong work ethic, and it stated that if one does not have enough ambition to be industrious in life, go to the ant and learn its ways. So earlier today, I was typing with a Mac, and there were some ants on my Mac, and I don't know why. I told the ants, there is nothing for you here. It's a Mac. It looks like an apple, but it doesn't mean anything. And though it won't listen, they were busy. Busier than an ant. Okay? And if you can see an ant, they are industrious creatures. Okay? They will continue on. Day or night. No? They are continuously working. We had a problem there, right there in the abundant table earlier. We just sang a few things. Suddenly, ants started to show up. And it's because of their hard work ethic. It's not an ambition, it's the understanding that they needed to accomplish something. How happy it is for a person that when we are about to go to sleep, we can tell ourselves we've accomplished something today. Who here came home from the retreat and they just slept right away? I did. Who did? I'm not going to tell you guys that you're slothful. I'm going to tell you that you and we and every one of us, by God's grace, accomplished something great those 2 days. That's why you felt that it was all right for you to rest. Amen? And that's exactly it. God wants you to rest, but He doesn't want you to become slothful. Okay? Too much of something is not good. And that's the thing, if you are sleeping the whole time and not talking to anyone and just, you know, imprisoned in your own cell, then, you know, there's no movement. There's no change. You're not encouraging anyone. You're going to get stuck and, you know, your growth is not going to be there. And there is no movement for us. And that is scary. Amen?
Amen.
So Proverbs 6:6-8 states, okay, could I ask Tanya to read this? Winchell is telling that to himself.
Go to the ant, ye sluggard, consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer or ruler. Yet it stores its provisions in summer and gathers its food in harvest.
Amen. Thank you, Tanya. Alrighty, so that's exactly it right there. Consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer, no ruler, yet it stores its provisions in summer and gathers its food at harvest. Now understand, the ants are not, in any sense, intelligent beings. They can't talk. They have antennas to tell themselves what's going on. And they have a hive mentality. Okay? Yet, all of them, if they were human beings, are all going to be summa cum laude and stuff. Why? Because they just continue to work. And they're all going to be Steve Jobs, and they're all going to be Bill Gates, and they're all going to be the greatest inventors there are, because the thing is, iba ang diligence nila, iba yung sipag nila. And that's truth. I've seen in my time in high school that a very intelligent child could pass a test without even studying, but a person who studies continuously will always pass the test because they're diligent and they prepare. And that's it right there. That's the movement as to what Solomon is trying to share. Now that statement is very true, and it is a literal right, because the understanding here is that Israel is an agriculture society. an agricultural society. When I say that, that means they get their food from planting, sowing and reaping, and at the same time, they also get their food from, pagpapastol, no? Or having livestock. So mean to say, if the farmers didn't wake up early in the morning or in the right time, it won't reach the harvest. Amen? The plants won't grow for the harvest. The wheat won't grow for the harvest. There'd be no threshing in the harvest. And same way that if they didn't wake up and everyone was lazy, then the wolves would eat the sheep. And there'd be no food for everyone. So meaning to say, in that society, if one stood lazy, it could mean starvation for all. Amen?
Amen.
Starvation for all. Not only can sloth corrode your soul, but it could lead to your hunger and death and the end of those dear to you. And that's the scary part over here. Slothfulness does not only affect us spiritually, it affects us physically. If we're sinning in sloth, we're not hurting anybody but ourselves and the people around us. The people who we love the most. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? Praise God. Alrighty. So in 390 BC, many Greek philosophers preached the value of hard work, save one. And his name is Diogenes. As you can see, he lives in Athens, this man. Athens is the city of what? The city of great thinkers. The city of great thinkers. Okay? The city of great thinkers. Here we see Aristotle and Plato and every single philosopher of the Western or the classical age. And then we see Diogenes. And Diogenes, as you can see depicted in this picture, is sitting down in a water barrel, half naked, dirty, rugged, unkempt, and with the dogs. Okay? And his standpoint was, why work? Why have a career? Why use up vast amounts of time and resources to get wealth or pleasure when it will fade away? Enjoy the moment. Live simple. Okay? Now, I'm not telling you not to become simplistic or minimalist. But I'm telling you that maybe the Diogenes here might have gone too far with his teaching. Because he didn't do anything. His life was all about just staying there in that water barrel, walking around the streets. He was proudly homeless. He didn't have a job. I truly wondered how he ate, okay? And then he would tell everyone, he would laugh at anyone who was working, okay? And he'd tell them, why are you doing these things? If you saw the video, he just kept on pointing at himself. Look at me. I'm all right. I'm fine. I'm simple. It works out. Everything works out. Now, Alexander the Great, enamored by Diogenes' teaching, seeked an audience with the man. And so this is one of the paintings over here of Alexander and Diogenes. And Alexander said, name anything that you want, and I will give it to you. He could have asked for half the kingdom. Diogenes could have. But what did Diogenes say? Move, because you're blocking the light. I pictured this actual scene as a kung fu movie. You know, so Alexander comes up and says, "Hey, master, why are you? What? I can give you anything. I give you whatever you want. Tell me what you want." And you know, the Diogenes is like, you know, he looks up and he says, "You're crazy." Move! You're blocking the light! So yeah, it's all Bruce Lee, really. Yeah. Stephen Chow. So I can actually see how that would move as. And you can see that the Diogenes was not only that, but he was stubborn. But notice that Alexander had everything and the Diogenes had nothing. Yet who lived happier? There's a sense to what the Diogenes is saying, as simplistic, but the main context here is that he completely didn't want to do anything. He was lazy to a point where nothing was going to happen in his life. There'd be no legacy for his children. There'd be no heritage for himself. He was dealing only with how he was going to live, not with how his family was going to make it through. Amen? And he was too happy with what he was learning. Now, 300 years later, Jesus Christ came and preached about living in simplicity. Now, this is where it gets questionable with the History Channel. Okay? Yet, Christ didn't state anything about succumbing to laziness or sloth. What he meant by simplicity is found in Matthew 6, 26. Okay? It stated here, "Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they?" Now notice here the misconstrued notion of the History Channel by stating that Jesus stood the same as Diogenes did. Okay? That's why we can't just watch anything and say that's great. You need to kind of study and really read the word. That's why they didn't write down, they didn't give you context there. They didn't even give you the actual verse. You need to try to find it. Okay? That's why Paul stood right with Jesus in his statement. Because let's see, Jesus did not mean lazy. Did not mean to be or state that we should be lazy. Jesus was telling us that before we should seek these things, riches, power, clothes, food, anything, our needs and our wants, we should seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. That's what He was focusing on. Before you do anything, seek Me first. That's what He was stating to everyone. Okay? Not to worry about what the pagans seek, but seek God first, and everything shall be added unto you. The actual verse is found here in Matthew 6, 31 to 33, which states, "So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows what you need them, that you need them." Okay? "But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Okay? The focus here is that God understands what we need. And He is going to grant us the strength, the wisdom, and the discernment to accomplish something or do work to get what we need and what we want. But if we don't focus on Him first, then we are just like the pagans, who that is their mode. That's their focus the whole time. To have a good life. That's about it. That's the period of it all. Okay? Have a good life. Don't even think about God. Just have a good life. Do whatever you want. And that's not what God wants. Because God knows that no matter what we have in our life, it will not suffice the void in our spirits that is a God-shaped hole, as Blaise Pascal once stated. Amen? Amen. And so that is why in 1 Thessalonians 5:14, when Paul states this, "Brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are lazy, encourage those who are timid, take tender care of those who are weak, be patient with everyone." There's a statement here that you should be warned of laziness. Amen?
Amen?
And that's what Paul was trying to state to everyone here. That he didn't want people to stand for laziness because Jesus wasn't standing for that. He was standing for a focus like none other. Focus on Me so that you can focus on these things and win them all. Amen? Because seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything shall be added on to you. Because marami po na hindi naman tamad pero hanggang ngayon naghihirap. Marami po mga tao na hindi naman tamad pero hanggang ngayon naghihirap. At meron din naman mga talagang tamad, no? Na talagang hindi naman talaga sila or talagang naghihirap din sila. And that's the statement right there. That's why, because there's no focus. Everyone's focusing on what the world is asking, not what God is telling them to do. So by this time, Western civilization focused on hard work, thus condemning sloth or laziness as Paul did. They deemed sloth deadly, understanding that it was the worst transgression to God. In Evagrius Ponticus classified sloth as two terms, Ascidia and Tristitia. Okay? Now let's look at Ascidia. Ascidia, can we read this all together? Is a creeping form of spiritual apathy or state of indifference. Sucks all your motivation. You don't try, you don't care. It's a literal burnout in today's term. Spiritual apathy or a state of indifference. Okay, that is Ascidia. You lose all motivation to even try. Okay? It's the burnout state. No? Yung parang ayaw mo nang gumawa ng kahit ano. You're fine where you're at. Okay? Primarily, this sin is done by the monks. Tita Yufi, did you need that one? There it is. Okay, I can move on to that later on. Primarily, the sin is for the monks, no? And it shows as a basic peculiarity of the hermit. Now, why would we state these things, no? Ascidia, as to why that is there's a problem spiritually with a person with ascidia. A moment where he does not or she does not care about anyone around him or her. Okay? Yung parang nag-shutdown. Bigla. Walang pakialam. Okay? Kung ano man mangyari sa mga kasama niya, wala lang sa kanya yun kasi ang tingin niya ay sa sarili lamang niya. I don't care. Air. Okay? Now, primarily, the sin was done by the monk. What? Primarily, the sin was for the monks. Actually, it was a peculiarity for the hermit, and it kind of showed a simple thing with the monks. That suddenly, they were unhappy with where they were. They were unhappy with God's calling in their life. They're disgusted with his cell or where he lives in. And he himself has deep contempt for his brothers in the faith. Ascidia is a scary notion because usually what is targeted here are the people who are focused on God initially. There is a sense here that when ascidia moves, even those who we cared for, those who God said, beloved, let us love one another, you don't love anymore. Because you are just plainly focusing on yourself and on your problems and on the hate inside you and nothing more. You're just going to slowly deteriorate and diminish. That's when you don't care about what other people are going to view you as and you don't care about what's going to happen to the people you state stuff to. Amen? Amen. And this tears away the fiber as to who you were in the first place. Okay? Ito yung mga tao na what they do is they just slowly deteriorate. And when you ask them how they are, they're going to give you all these stories about how they're going to die soon. How easily they're just going to fall apart and die. And they forget that no one can tell us when we're going to die. God is the only one who knows. And the thing is, till that day comes that God really tells you, oh, you're going to die, I suggest you continue on the path of righteousness. Amen?
Amen.
Ascidia is scary because you have deep contempt for your brothers in the faith. You're angry at them. You despise them. You don't care for them anymore. That's why you're just like a log or a lamp. You're just there. Okay? Likewise, it renders him slothful, immobile to all the work he should do. So ito yung oras na yung biglang shutdown, apart from all this going on in his or her mind, and in her heart and in his mind, we have what's going on as well outside. They don't want to work. They don't want to do anything. They want to get stuck where they are. That's all that they want to do. And that is a scary notion because dyan po nakikita ang paghihirap ng isang tao. siya nakikita na wala silang kinikilalang Panginoon na buhay, na bumibigay sa atin ang motivation to move. Okay? God never said, you know, God never said anything that would pertain to us not doing anything. Even the simple salvation, we had to believe. We had to make an action in order to do it. Amen? Amen. The simple sanctification, there had to be something to do. And in the life of Jesus, he just kept on walking. There was no time that he lagged. He actually got angry at the disciples when they slept, when he told them, could you please stay with me during my last moments? And that's it right there. Now, acidia is complacency and apathy, unable to care for anything. It's spiritual morphine. Sino po dito nakakuha na ng morphine, ng dose ng morphine? Morphine. Okay? Okay. Yeah. Ipampamanhid. The pain is there, but it's dull. And that's it right there. If it's spiritual morphine, what it means is, can we say this all together?
A dulled life.
Because if we're going to dull everything, all pain of life, then we're forgetting what Paul stated, to look at every trial and pain in our life as a time to sharpen ourselves, to check ourselves, to become the best man, to become the better person. Amen?
Amen.
If we do that, then we dull all sense of existence. And we just let everything go. Now, Christistia is another one right here, which is intense and problematic. Can you read this all together, please? Christistia is sadness. It damages you, and in turn damages everyone around you. It is a spiritual disease that destroys faith. It draws everyone to depression, making everyone fall into a pit of despair. Christistia. Okay? Now, Christistia has a different context over here. Not only does it damage the person, but it damages everyone else. It damages them to a point that they feel sad and lonely and unkempt and can't feel anything and dull. And this is a scary concept because it means that everyone that the person was with nahawa dun sa kalungkutan nila. Okay? Yes, switch.
You know when David mourned for his son Absalom, it was supposed to be a day of victory, but instead, when he was mourning, everyone mourned with him.
Amen. Next point is Christistia is one simple term in the Bible. It's called ungodly grief. Ungodly grief. This is the time when you forget who you are, what God called you to do. This is a time when people start to forget that their main purpose in life is to encourage one another. Amen?
Amen.
Encourage each other, edify one another, not become, okay? Nakadantay na lang doon. Naghihingalo pero hindi pa naman namamatay. Kailangan ko lang pala na-spray. Ito na. Halagaan mo lahat ng tao dito. That's the problem right there. Everyone is all already crying, you know, weeping, you know, and saying, he was such a good man. And we were just so, I can't believe God is going to take this guy. But in our reality, God is looking down in heaven and saying, not yet. And by the way he's acting, I don't think of taking him anytime soon. Hindi yan mamamatay. Promise. Sabi ng Diyos, no? Because that's the thing, it destroys. Now let's look here. It's a spiritual disease. We can't get an antidote on it, except of course if we fix our eyes in Jesus and find joy in His presence.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. In our reality, that's also a very big problem. My mom never told me that my dad was dying because we didn't know how painful that would be for a child to handle.
Yeah.
Thus, you can be rest assured that that's really a sad thing. You're trying to steal the peace and the joy of a child, you know, by stating, "I'm dying." Okay?
Yeah.
In every single movie that I've seen so far, even Independence Day, the president dad said, "Okay, let mommy rest." That's as far as it went. There was no need to actually show anything. Okay? Even with Forrest Gump, they didn't show anything. Because why? Because the grief of losing someone without them actually being lost just yet is, I don't know, it's a demonic influence. It destroys every single piece on anyone, not even just a child. No, lahat ng mga karinig. Because, you know, death brings to our hearts a sense of our mortality as well. Okay, when we see a casket, we remember that our days are short and fleeting. And sometimes people take it as, I need to do much work like Steve Jobs did. And some people actually go so far as saying, well, there's no sense in trying to continue on. I'll just lie down, wait for my time. Well, the sad thing with that is magpuputulan siya ng kuryente at saka ng tubig bago siya mamatay. Ni pang wifi wala. Ni pang load wala. Bakit? Kasi, ano eh. Tristis, yeah. It's just, yeah. Go for it, yeah. Is there a question? Oh, yeah. Okay, I thought that you guys were calling me. Okay. Alright, it's a spiritual disease. It draws everyone to depression and making everyone fall into a pit of despair. Now let's review what despair means. Despair is deemed the greatest sin since it's the antithesis of faith. Through despair, unbelief is formed and faith is set aside. Understand, if we believe there is a God and we know He cares for the world, one ought never to despair. Because there's always hope.
Amen.
When we wake up in the morning, it means God has still blessed us with another day to fix the problems we have made.
Amen.
And that's the saddening part right there. Okay? When people start to focus on despair, they lose all faith and then they poison everyone else with their despair. And so we see problems not only with the people in the body of Christ, the family, but most especially, and let me just point this out to you parents, you see a spiritual manifestation of an attack to your children. That's the first step. You would see a sense of rebellion, you would see a sense of despair, of pain, of hurt in your children first, when you see testicia move. Why? Because there is a sense where these children are pure. Amen? All our wonderful youth, they are pure. From Sandra, from Bella, from Ashley, and Pauline, and Nicole, and Winchell, and Vlad, and Sean, and everyone. There is a purity there. Okay? In these children, in these kids. And you would know that there is a spiritual attack of sadness when you see that they in themselves are fighting something right away. Makita mo yung rebellion on it because the thing is, it's unnatural. Amen?
Amen.
There's unnatural effect right here. Friends, despair weighs heavily in each heart. And despair is a turning away from the life God has called you to. What has God called you to? For the thief comes to steal, kill, to destroy. But I come to give you life more abundant. That's the term of Jesus Christ right there. How come? So mean to say, if let's call it as it is, God has called us to what? Have a abundant life. He called us to have an abundant life. When I say abundant life, no? What do I mean by abundant? People always think it's riches, but in all reality, abundant is buhay na ganap. No? Buhay na ganap. It's a full life. That when you sleep at night, you tell yourself, I am so blessed. When you wake up in the morning, thank you, God, for blessing me with another day. You're content. Amen. Tama yun dito, Rudy. You are content. There is contentment in your heart, in your spirit. Okay? And that's what God is calling you to have. To have a content, happy, abundant life. When you don't see that in your spirit, it's either you are getting what? Nahawa kayo dun sa may tristisha or may asidya, or kayo mismo ang may asidya or tristisha. And sloth is like pride. And pride is like B.O. And you have no clue that you have B.O. up until someone gives you Rexona for Christmas. Or tawas. Old school. Pero mas gumagana daw eh. We don't know. But the biggest thing is that we need to be on guard. Amen? We need to be on guard not only for ourselves but for our children and our children's children. Notice that the biggest remedy and the antidote to sloth is one thing. Okay? One thing alone. It's the understanding of faith in God. Because faith in God leads to several wonderful things, which is good work, good works. And what is work? It is something you do and accomplish. If you have that, then you won't fall into sloth. But if you don't have that, if you don't have faith, if you have unbelief in your heart, then it is easy for us to fall into sloth because God has not never been our focus, but our focus has been ourselves all along. So I plead with you, people here in Abundant Harvest Fellowship, my brothers and sisters, to stand up for God regardless, to focus on God, and make sure to always understand what quarantine means. What does quarantine mean? Anyone? Quarantine? It's a beautiful term. Quarantine. Quarantine. To separate. Okay, to quarantine. To isolate. I don't want to use Jason right now, but I will. Jason has a viral infection right now. And he chose not to show up here in this church because of one simple thing. He doesn't want to allow anyone to get what he has. He doesn't want any child to have what he has. And that's exactly it right there. If we care for our brothers and sisters, if we do love the body of believers, then we have to understand what it means to quarantine. Okay? When someone has asidya, has tristitia, and he's falling into complete sloth, we can preach to them, but unless they are really active to listen, they'll just be lazy and slothful not to understand what's going on. And that's when we have planted the seed, but we allow God to move on our behalf and allow God to move in their life. We cannot be Messiah to this people. We cannot change them. We never had the power to do so. But we have the power to change ourselves by God's grace. Okay? Friends, if you love this people, you will let God move in their lives. And if you love yourself and you love your children, you will allow God to move in your life, in your children's life. That asidya, tristitia, sloth, or any of the seven deadly sins won't move in their life and not have a foothold on them. Amen? So as I end, 2 Corinthians 4, 16 to 18 states, and let's read this all together. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. I like this part. When you start feeling sloth coming to you, do not lose heart. Do not lose heart. Look at the troubles that you face as momentary struggles, only to bring you an eternal glory that outweighs all hurts, all wrongs. Trials come, friends. Problems do come. But the last thing we want to do is become burnt out that we don't want to deal with this. God wants us to deal with it, not by our might, but by focusing on Him alone. And that's what He wants for us to accomplish and do. To fix our eyes on Him. Amen? Not on the problems, but on Him. If we do this, sloth will not come to us. Because there is a movement. There is an action. There is a motion that has to be accomplished.